20 years ago, Lester Brown, the founder of World Watch Institute, published a famous book, Who Will Feed China? He claimed that China's population growth would starve people in other countries. Although China introduced its own domestic brand in the 1950s, Chinese consumers still prefer foreign brands. I wonder how China can develop its own auto brands. How can China compete against the world's best?
We not only face competition from domestic competitors, but also face competition from foreign companies. They have imported the world's strategic cars at the fastest speed into China.
To realize the Chinese dream, China's leaders say that China must be strong. But what does a strong China mean? What in terms of China's economy, military, society, science, and culture? I'm Robert Lawrence Kuhn. For 25 years, I've been coming to China. I wrote the book, How China's Leaders Think. I give commentaries about China. I follow the Chinese dream. China today is the world's second largest economy. China's Chang'e 3 spacecraft landed on the moon. The aircraft carrier Liaoning is in active service. The submersible Jialong does deep sea dives. China has the fastest supercomputer, the most high speed trains. However, is China really so strong? How strong is China? Science and technology have become prime drivers of global competitiveness, a decisive factor in the fate of nations. For 1,000 years, China led the world in science. But when China turned insular, it fell far behind the West and into abject decline. China's leaders today promote science. When the Chinese Academies of Science and Engineering hold their biennial meeting, China's top leaders attend for the full day. I know of no other country where senior leaders pay so much attention to science. China has a long history of oceanographic culture. It was once the leader in navigation technology. And the maritime Silk Road fostered interaction between East and West. Now China is determined to become a leader in exploring the deep seas. In Shanghai, I meet Professor Sui Wei Chung. He was the deputy designer of Jialong, China's deep sea manned submersible that dived to a depth of over 7,000 meters.
Jialong,
Sui was born into an ordinary rural family. He studied in the UK, then gave up his well-paying job to return to China. He and his wife and son still live in a small apartment of only 60 square meters.
当初公派留学的，大概是他是算是最早的一批回来的了。那时候也是哦，很多人劝我们不要回来。当初要说回国，肯定是有斗争的啦，因为他刚刚博士后出来，而且也准备续签合同了嘛。这时候他突然之间说接到国内的原来这个导师，那么他就答应了。当时开始我不知道。
After his return, Sui became the director of the 702 Research Institute, which launched the Jiaolong submersible project.
When you first arrived at the 702 Institute, what were some of the issues and problems you faced?
当时实际上发现主要有两大困难。第一个，我们这个团队非常的不完整，而且没有经验，我们实际团队里边没有一个人是看见过真正的载人潜水器是什么样子的，所以这个因为他们原来只是搞过无人的潜水器，第二个就是刚才团队我只有十来个人，远远不够的。
越走时间越多了，反而
实际上距离远了，
距离远了，
对对对。
The research team has three generations of scientists.
因为可能这里我们造个有机玻璃造纸，把整个都造进去，
对，
要用的时候再放。我这里要收回去，
对。
Xu Qinan is the general designer.An academician nearly 80 years old, his lifelong dream is to help China develop its own deep-sea manned submersible.
那么从92年开始呢，我们国内也很明确，就是有海底资源的那个调查跟开采的事，而且我们已经拿到了国际海底管理局的一块东太平洋那个夏威夷南边的地区7.5万平方公里的那个锰基核的矿区都拿到了，所以大量的工作，我们一方面要勘察，一方面要准备开采做准备，所以这方面的工作任务是很重很重，需要的潜水器要很多很多的，所以你载人肯定是要有。
Born in the late 1970s, Ye Zong is one of the first oceanauts chosen for Jiaolong.
我们的第一批的潜航员和试航员都是研制团队里面的人员，我们一起在设计画图做实验，然后当这个潜器建成好以后，我们就可以亲自去操作它驾驶它，这样的话我们就实现了从一个研制团队到一个试验团队的这样的一个比较蜕变，叫一个提升嘛，叫提升。
这个载人潜水里面有三个人，是一个驾驶员带两个科学家这样的模式。那个我们平时的在舱里边工作就是这样的一个姿态，然后一天工作最长我们设计要12个小时。腿如果酸的话，那么你要稍微伸一伸脚碰上那个同事，站起来稍微动一动也是可以的，但是一般情况就是这个也是一个基本功。
In 2009, Jiaolong began its first sea trials.
船一开出长江口，正好遇到了莫拉克台风。然后我们船顶着台风航行，航到南海去，结果在路上就是颠簸得很厉害。我们的试航员好几，他们这个有一些害怕的心理。我就跟总指挥说了，我自己带头下去。我们连续示范了几次，那么后来我们的那个调试人员他们也不再害怕了。后来以后就把它变成一个规矩了，某到一个新的海区，第一个下去肯定是我要参加。
压力最大的时候就每次出海的时候，因为每次出海这个船离码头以后，我们每个人给就是要承担很多的工作。而且给我们的后方，就是说给内地、给祖国大陆啊联系很少，所以说一些物资水平、物资啊供给啊干嘛都非常的稀少，所以说我们就当时只能依靠我们船上自己来解决问题。尤其我们四年海试碰到好多不可预知的问题，当时每次出海的时候都感觉到，我回去以后一定要去换一个工作。
因为蛟龙号上我们有40%的设备是从国外进口的，所以怎么样把这些设备实现国产化，作为那个头等的那个需求。为了这个目的呢，科技部又立了一个4500米的 载人潜水器，但是在我们做蛟龙号的同时，国际上在冲击11000米，所以我在想，我的同事他们这个原来蛟龙号的团队，他们做4500应该可以了，我自己一个人出来，再组建一个团队，我们同步为11000米做一些前期的准备。
Tui had a dream to build China's first 11,000-meter manned submersible to descend to the ocean's deepest trenches. But to realize his vision, he felt he needed to leave the government and go independent.
这就执着，对一件事情认准了就不放弃的，再怎么困难。7000米成功以后，你说你好好的在那单位里面继续做。人家跳出来自己干，冒那么大风险，说实话什么都没有，从零开始就不相信，要从头开始了，组建队伍，硬件软件什么都没有，他就自己决定了，自己要这样。后来他的导师劝，大家劝，没有了。
In addition to the technical challenges, Sui must secure the funding by himself.He began speaking to private companies, and he formed a design team at Shanghai Ocean University.
整个这个需要的这个资金呢，大概是在10亿这个人民币这样的一个规模。那么我这一次做11000米的这个系统的话，我的思路是这样的：潜水器，我载人潜水器，我向国家去申请经费；母船，我不向国家去申请。我找民间资金去想办法来寻求他们的支持，然后用一种市场经济的方式来进行运作。那么如果你要民营企业要给你捐钱的话，首先就是你自己要带头捐，如果你自己不捐的话，没有说服力的。我一开始要叫夫人去捐的话，她肯定不一定会同意，因为她是一个我们很辛辛苦苦，我们不是一个企业家。那么，所以这样一刻呢，我就先从我的儿子下手，我就跟我儿子谈，我要做追梦，要做这个事，那个应该不应该支持？所以我儿子后来表态支持了，然后我儿子跟我一起说服他。
说实话，一开始的时候也是觉得那个什么，就是说也不是完全理解了。说是科，他搞科学搞研究，本身就是搞科研人员，本身就工资就很低，完了以后他。还要拿自己的钱去做科研，所以因为你搞科研主要是为国家的嘛，他就觉得房子小温馨，还可以减轻我打扫卫生的负担呢。
This is a key component.
With the support of family, friends, and entrepreneurs, Sui Weicheng designed the 11,000-meter deep-sea submersible.Called Rainbow Fish and its mothership.
This is all together. We call it a movable laboratory for the head of science. And this is will be the future the mothership.
And how big is the mothership?
4,000 tons, about 60 passengers in total, about 40 scientists and 20 ship crews.Right. So in the future, our model is that take one scientist and one
business person,
to dive, see the deep sea world. So this is the economic model to operate.
Very good.
We've reached that critical stage for deep sea exploration, and other nations are doing it. Russia, Japan, India, the United States, a handful of countries.Are making that investment for industry, for oil and gas exploration, and as that deep sea mining is coming on the horizon. But this is that moment when whoever it is who steps up and makes that investment can be in the leadership group. And China has a chance to be right there in the forefront. And in so many ways, China is already there.
China's President Xi Jinping champions the vision to build China into a maritime power. He stresses marine resources development, marine science and technology, and safeguarding national rights and interests in the seas, making the ocean a new area of China's economic growth. To get the government's view, I go to China's State Oceanic Administration and meet its Deputy Director, Wang Fei.He explains China's strategy of building a maritime power.
中国梦和海洋敲个梦，实际上我们这个内涵呢，主要是以海富国，以海强国，啊，总体体现这么一个理念。啊，海洋梦的话，首先我们是要认知海洋，然后现在要保护海洋，要保护好海洋环境。那么海洋的开发过度的问题，造成污染的问题，是吧？再就是要开发好海洋，啊，然后再就是要管控海洋，啊，对海洋的管理工作要管控海洋，啊，再一个层面就是要和谐海洋。
In 2013, China's ocean-derived GDP approached $900 billion, almost 10% of China's total GDP. By developing advanced marine technology and with its maritime economy booming, China is becoming a maritime power. This worries certain foreign countries as various voices warn of the China threat.
那么在这个中华民族的特点呢，我们现在是都是这个睦邻友好啊，从来都是都把我们周边的国家都是涉海的海洋国家都是本来要友好啊，变成这个生态之海，是吧？友谊之海，是吧？不会发展强大了以后就是称霸，我个人认为是一些偏见。
Just as China's maritime industries are poised to become global leaders, China's corporate giants are trying to develop their own brands, seeking share of domestic and global markets. But creating new brands is a challenge. China's automotive industry is a national pillar industry. It exemplifies China's industrial strength. I've marveled how China has become the world's largest auto market, producing over 20 million vehicles a year. The number of private cars is nearly 100 million. Although China introduced its own domestic brand in the 1950s, Chinese consumers still prefer foreign brands.I wonder how China can develop its own auto brands. How can China compete against the world's best? I visit Shanghai Automotive Industry Corporation, SAIC. A state-owned enterprise operating for 60 years, Shanghai Auto epitomizes China's auto industry.Shanghai Auto is China's largest car manufacturer. I sense its commitment to fresh ideas and new technologies.
那我记得当时呢，国内的自主品牌呢都是几万元的这样一个低端的轿车。那么我们呢选择是从二十几万元的这个中高端轿车入手，而且呢我们不但面临着国内同行的这样的一个竞争，更面临着合资企业。他们把全球的战略车型啊，用最快的速度引进到中国，啊，同时呢，他们的价格也在不停地往下探，啊，这对我们来说形成了一个巨大的一个市场压力。为了长期的战略呢，我们放弃了暂时的一些利润。那么在这些举动呢，在于我们这样普通的员工眼里，也是非常需要勇气和挑战的。
But successful automotive brands cannot be created in isolation behind closed doors.Shanghai Auto has many years' experience as the prime joint venture partner of General Motors and Volkswagen. To develop its own brand, Shanghai Auto's policy is to access the world's best components. In 2006, SAIC Motor Passenger Vehicle Corporation was founded to create its own auto brand. Zhu Yong runs powertrain development.
当时我们上汽是从罗孚，不错，我们收购了它的很多知识产权，那么可以用汗牛充栋这么一个词来形容当时我们拿到这么多的材料。 那我们的工程师坐在一起，也是包括我们也有英国技术中心的同事一起来通过研究，就是说逐图纸的去看。但是罗孚的知识产权相对当时我们中国市场的产品来是还是存在一定的差距的，所以在这个吸收的过程中，其实还是有我们自己的提升。
Lu Yong and colleagues had difficulties in developing the chassis.
以往在开发的时候，通过车会过来，反过来再来制造零部件，那么这个就是一个逆向开发的一个过程。那么现在往往是讲究，是我整个平台的硬点的布置到零部件的开发，都是从原始的设计开始，那么不依赖于任何一个现有的产品。这是一个底盘各系统的硬件在环虚拟系统，有了个方向盘输入过后，车子会马上转向，接着就是横摆，完全在测试之前可以通过虚拟把它通过我们的计算能够得到。
今晚亮相的荣威750是基于英国罗孚750平台。 In October 2006, Shanghai Auto's self-owned car brand, Rouway, was launched, targeting mid and high-end markets, competing with foreign brands.Rapidly, the Rouway 750 took a leading position in its niche as a domestic brand. To Shanghai Auto, it was only a beginning. Relentless development is essential. A major innovation was informationalized cars, the InConnect Intelligent Network Travel System. Yan Feng is excited to tell me about Shanghai Auto's information technologies.
Our consumer was born in 1980s and the 1990s. They like to use IT technology, or they used to use that. So they have a new requirement for cars, especially in digital area. Mm. So there's a chance for us to build a new competence.
I asked Yan Feng about the IT innovations.
So Yan Feng, where is your car?
Don't worry, we can use our cell phone to find our car.
Oh, okay.
Open the application and choose that what is your position and where's the car position, and choose the road here and you can find it. Okay.
So we find it?
Yeah. That's our
okay.
car.
Okay. Okay, very good.
Yeah, you try.
Thank you. Cool.
导航
需要我带你去哪里？
人民广场
People Square.
Yeah. Okay, that's the navigation. We'll start. Hi, robot. You want to listen music?
Sure. Music.
Normally, they used to touch screen, but use our voice recognition. You don't need to talk at screen.Over 80% accident is because the distraction.
Yeah.
So the internet can help them to avoid the tragedy.
This is our new model. Mm. So we use this.
Born in the 1970s, Hao Fei joined Shanghai Auto's joint venture after graduation. Years later, he joined Shanghai Auto's development of its cell phone brand.Hao Fei is responsible for developing InConnect. His department now has over 200 staff.
How many in your team have come from the joint ventures?
It's 10. You know, actually, so when we work for joint ventures, sometimes it's very hard to change the core technology. Even so, we have some new idea, but it's very hard to realize it. You know, a lot of people, those...who left joint ventures to come here. So maybe they, you know, have less paid, less money, and also more hard work, and also more pressure. Yeah, but I think they are all heroes.
To include InConnect in Shanghai Auto's new cell phone brand was a big decision. It's risky to put a new product into a new car.I'm surprised to learn that the time from development to production took only 1 year, but problems came in succession. Shanghai Auto's partners couldn't understand InConnect. To test the system, I simulate a car problem.
Okay, so if something's wrong with my car and I want to stop here,
you can push this button, enter.
Thank you for calling. What can I do for you?
Ni hao, yes, I'm having some trouble with my car.
Okay, please wait a moment. According to our remote diagnosis, there's something wrong with your tire. We've already sent a crew to you.
Thank you very much.
15 minutes later, a repair crew arrives. InConnect has had much success, but Shanghai Auto refuses to be satisfied with the status quo. On the contrary, they embrace crises. Recently, Shanghai Auto and the Alibaba Group, China's largest internet enterprise, joined in strategic cooperation to develop the Internet of Cars. In May 2014, President Xi Jinping visited Shanghai Auto. Hearing that the Roway 950 is a mid to high-end domestic brand, he got in. Xi said that leadership has decided that Chinese government cars must be Chinese domestic brands. Now, thanks to domestic brands, more ordinary people can enjoy modern life. I appreciate Shanghai Auto's dream of its own brand because it reflects the Chinese dream of national prosperity that is self-reliant, not dependent on foreigners, but founded on indigenous ingenuity and productivity. To vivify the Chinese dream, China must be an automotive power. But for China to be truly strong, its strength cannot be limited to eastern coastal regions. A strong China must encompass all China, including its less developed inland central and western regions, which lag far behind. Although China is the second largest economy in the world, its per capita income is still low. A prime reason is large-scale imbalances, economic and social, between East and West. The only solution is to develop the West. Fifteen years ago, China established its Great Western Strategy. Today, the city of Chengdu, the capital of Sichuan Province, is called the engine of China's Western development. And the city stands at a crossroads. I'm at the Chengdu Qingbaijiang Station, the start of the Chengdu Europe Express Railway. The train will span Eurasia, transiting many countries, including Kazakhstan, Russia, and Belarus, arriving in 14 days at Lutz in Poland, from where goods are distributed all across Europe. The route is called the New Silk Road.
As an inland city, Chengdu faced a logistics bottleneck, which constrained its economic development. Goods had to be transported to Shanghai, Shenzhen, or other coastal cities by road or rail before being shipped around the world. To landlocked Chengdu, logistics is imperative. Chengdu intends to become the new land port linking China and Europe. Cheng Zhongwei is director of Chengdu's Office of Logistics Management. His office must coordinate with railroads, airlines, customs, logistics, and governments of all the countries along the route, negotiating with each country one by one.
So, you have to open up this path. You have such a network. In the past, we talked about one country and 一个国家的城市跟这个城市之间点到点的飞嘛，你现在是多个点对一个点，所以我们想利用你的优势把这个事情把它好好处理一下。
I meet Cheng Zhongwei in the eastern terminus of Chengdu's new Silk Road. He tells me about Chengdu's new transport vision.
大概运行时间是14天，我们这辆火车是每周开一列，每一列装40个集装箱，与空运相比，它的成本仅相当于空运的五分之一。它对于一些高附加的产品，它具有很强的一个。
What's the role of the New Silk Road in developing a strong China?
最核心的是，新丝绸之路和长江经济带，能够把它连接到一起。对西部而言，过去我们只能沿着单向的通道，向东去发展。或者向南发展，通过新丝绸之路，这个打通成都跟欧洲的对接以后，我们可以实现过去这个被动的承接产业转移，变为我们主动的和欧洲加强经贸往来联系。
It's not easy. Many of Chengdu's entrepreneurs worry about cost. Compared to shipping by sea, the price of the Chengdu Europe Express Railway is higher.They hope the government can help reduce costs with subsidies.
从铁路运输的话，这开一趟班列开过去就需要41个集装箱，甚至更多的集装箱。那么这种情况下，在前期没有人认识的情况下，我们讲跟港口不同的是，铁路运输的话，它这个沿途各国家是要收费的。它一个集装箱的成本，尽管比空运便宜，但是一个集装成本也需要$10,000+。那么对这件事情，各种压力都来了。
This unique logistics problem requires a unique China solution. Chengdu has also added flights to Europe, the Middle East, and North America, becoming China's fourth largest air hub.Leveraging its central location in China and between Europe and Southeast Asia, Chengdu is becoming a transportation hub and regional economic center. European manufacturers can make their products in Chengdu and ship them to their home markets. Nearly half of the world's top 500 companies have facilities here. China's strategy has transformed Chengdu's industrial structure.I am amazed by Chengdu's modernization. But unbalanced development among China's regions, especially China's less developed central and western regions, remains a major challenge facing the Chinese government. If reducing unequal development is critical for China, then assuring food security is essential for the world. 20 years ago, Lester Brown, the founder of World Watch Institute, published a famous book, Who Will Feed China?
你好。
He claimed that China's population growth would starve people in other countries. There's an old saying in China that food is the first necessity. China has 22% of the world's population, but only 7% of the world's farmlands. China's population increases by 14 million people every year. China cannot be strong while depending on large quantities of imported food. Changsha, the capital of Hunan province, is the hub of central eastern China. There's a man here whose name is known to almost everyone in China, Yuan Longping, the father of hybrid rice. Planted widely in China, Yuan's hybrid rice has greatly increased China's food production. This year, the 85-year-old scientist is nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize.
Rice 不然呢，不知道我们中国的智慧，三大国里头粮食都水稻是老大。
Since the 1960s, Yuan Longping has studied hybrid rice, continually increasing the per unit area yield. He's still doing so, flying to Hainan province, experimenting with hybrid rice.
We Chinese super-cultivar was started in 1996. It was divided into four stages. The third stage is being promoted. The fourth stage is being promoted to achieve this year. 保证明年突破就是1000公斤，我肯定有秘密武器啊，我有个核武器，我的核武器啊，就是第五期超级道已经有了苗头，懂了吧？那就是说，每公斤产16吨的。
During the past 20 years, the number of people who go hungry in China decreased by nearly 100 million. Jose Graziano da Silva, Director General of the UN Food and Agriculture Organization, stated that China's success is the biggest factor in decreasing world hunger.
Enormous progress in China and India, which altogether represent almost 40% of the world population. The fact that China and, as we say, India more or less are able to feed their own population is a huge, huge contribution to the global stability and peace, in my opinion.
Yuan Longping's life is coupled with hybrid rice, and he has two dreams.
一个梦呢，就是禾下乘凉梦。我梦见我这个四点田这个超级杂交稻啊，长得比高粱还高，穗子有扫帚那么长，籽粒花生米那么好高兴呢，我就坐到那个稻穗下乘凉呢，这是真正做了梦的呢。第二个梦，就是杂交水稻覆盖全球梦。
I meet Brett Rearson, director of the World Food Program's China office.
This looks like parboiled rice.
Since entering China, the WFP has witnessed remarkable changes.
From 1979 until 2005, yes, the World Food Program was the largest partner for China, with over $1 billion coming into China. 30 million beneficiaries in every province in China. Okay, in the late 2000s, China was the third largest food donor in the world. So things have changed. Things have changed. The relationship that we've had with China has certainly evolved.
global food security remains problematic. According to the UN, almost 90 million people are suffering from chronic malnutrition, the vast majority in developing countries.
China is actually one of the very few countries that has continued to invest in agricultural research at a massive scale, at a governmental level. Throughout the world, investments in agriculture have declined over the 90s and the 2000s. But China actually has continued to invest in this. And we're intrigued also to see what's happening now in terms of China taking its story to other developing countries, Africa in particular.
现在在国外，一二年的数字，有七八个国家已经在大面积生产上应用，总面积达到了520万公顷，平均每公顷增产2吨粮食。哪些国家呢？印度、越南、孟加拉、印度尼西亚、菲律宾等等，这些都是发展中国家。
Chinese food scientists are cooperating with the international community. Food is a worldwide issue. Imbalances between food supply and demand have become worrisome.
You know, the world population is going to increase. The food demand will increase even more than the world population due to changes in diet and people get more money to pay food for. And when you combine that challenge with the expected challenges created by the climate change, I think we realize that securing food production for the future should be the top priority worldwide.
A recent concern in China is that the country's farmlands and fertile lands are shrinking.
18亿亩红线一定要保呢，这个不得了了，这个是生命线呢，是吧？这个我们在努力提高单产，他在那里把粮田都占了，就麻烦你这个等于零了，是吧？你个增产之后，是吧？这个要下最大的决心，是吧？这个侵占良田的，是吧？ 绝对允许，是吧？国土资源部这个南当呢，一方面要保良田，一方面要发展。
Moreover, many Chinese farmers are less willing to do farm work.
他效益低了，他在外面打工，一天100多块钱，打几个，他种一稻要4-5个月，产呢1000多块钱。
The part that I'm intrigued with right now is how do you make China's greatest export to the world its ability to solve hunger? China has huge potential for soft power projection by taking what it's done successfully from a food security point of view and from a health perspective and extending universal health care, for example, in a developing country.
So what does it mean for China to be strong? To Professor Cui, it's the knowledge, capacity, and ambition to explore the deepest oceans in a Chinese-designed submersible. To Shanghai Auto, it's creating a cell phone Chinese brand car that can compete with world-class brands. To Chengdu, it's the city of Chengdu linking China and Europe and developing China's Great West. To Yuan Longping, it's Chinese science and ingenuity feeding a hungry world.
China has made enormous progress, but much is yet to do. China will be strong when all its citizens live their lives with satisfaction and when the country sits comfortably at the high table of great nations. President Xi Jinping put forth the grand vision of the Chinese dream as the great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation. That rejuvenation must include all elements of national strength. To realize the Chinese dream, China must be strong.